It's dead. It's a noun. Oh, look at that corpse. That dead body. That's a noun. Amen? A casket is a noun. A coffin is a noun. But church, a verb shows action. That's the difference. A verb shows action. So faith is a noun. The word faith is a noun. But belief is a verb. When you believe, you are doing something. Are you with me this morning? So faith without belief is dead. That's what I'm saying. If you have faith and you don't believe, then there's nothing there. If you have faith without the works, the action to show that you believe in what you are saying, then it's dead. Hear me. If you believe, that means you are acting on God's promises. When you truly believe the word of God, you will act on it. Church, tell me this morning. When Satan threatens you with death, show him how the resurrection works. I have said that over and over again. I have just come from a place where over the last 2 weeks, we have been struggling with attempts at the lives of precious people to us. We were at the place where we were almost losing people who were close to us in this church. But we stood on the promises of God. Amen. Oh, you are not going to believe it. I said we stood on the promises of God. And today, we have good news. We have a newness of life.
Amen.
People who were on the verge of death, breathing and losing their breath. Today, God has put breath into them because God has reminded us that we reminded him his promises are true. I am saying to you, we must let the devil know how resurrection works. Amen? And let me remind you again what it says in Hebrews 9, 27. It says, it is appointed unto a man to die once.
Yes.
Let me remind you, God says it is appointed unto a man to die once, and after that judgment. Tell me your name, say death is an appointment.
Yes.
Say death is an appointment.
Yes.
Let me ask you the question, do you know when you are going to die? Do you? Guess what? But if you know the promises of God concerning your life, then you will know that you will only die when God calls you. Not when somebody tells you you will die. You will only die when God calls you. That's what it means to know the promises of God. Are you hearing me? Shout glory. So when sickness or death comes against you, when an appointment of sickness and death comes to you, what do you do? Does it mean that God is in it because death is looking at you? Because you are sick with some bad illness, does that mean that God is in that thing? It doesn't mean that God is in it. It is the devil trying to take your life. But does it mean God is in it? I am saying something for you to understand. What do you do when you can't meet an appointment? You cancel it. Do you know you can cancel death? Church, you can cancel death. You can say, not today. I am not dying today. Not today, church. I refuse to die. You can cancel it. Because if you know the promises of God, you can cancel that appointment. You have canceled so many appointments in your life. The doctor's appointment, the job appointment, appointment to go to a party, to do things. You cancel it. Waste your, lose sleep over it. And yet the enemy comes to take your life. And you say, okay, come, let me compare you. Take it. Because I'm going to die. The doctor tells you that this is it. This is, we have no hope. And you say, okay, oh doctor, you said I'm going to die. So you agree with the doctor. And now you're waiting to die. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. Hallelujah. It is an illegal appointment for you to die before your time.
Amen.
Oh, hear me. I didn't say you will not die. I said when you die before your time, it's an illegal appointment. And therefore you must cancel it. The only way you can cancel it is if you know the promises of God. Do you know the promises of God?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Talk to your neighbor. Tell them. Tell the devil, not now, devil. Not today. Not today. Not today. My loved one is not going to die. I am not going to lose my life. Not today. Oh, somebody say not today. Not today. If you have a loved one who is sick in hospital, let the devil know. Not today. Not today. Somebody has to get angry. You have to get angry. Not today. When you are situation. Let me give you a scripture. Romans 4:17. Look at the two scriptures when you are faced with it. Romans 4:17. It says, even God that quickens the dead. That's one of the promises of God. He quickens the dead. It means God will put life into a dead body. Even God who quickens the dead and calls those things that be not as though they are. That's what it says. Hallelujah. Romans 8:11. Look at what it says. Romans 8:11. It says, but if the same spirit, somebody said the same spirit, that raised Jesus from the dead, if that spirit lives in you, oh, then it says, that spirit will quicken your mortal body. If that spirit raised Jesus from the dead, and that spirit is in you, why will your mortal body not be quickened? You are not hearing me this morning. Somebody say glory. That's why you must speak life to death situations. Somebody say, I speak life. I speak life to every death situation. Look at what God says. I'm giving you these promises. Isaiah 62:6-7. Maybe you've not seen this scripture, but let me give it to you. Isaiah 62:6-7. You look at what it says. It says, I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace, neither day nor night. Somebody say, do not hold your peace. You that make mention of the Lord, do not keep silence. He says, you that pray to God, you that remember the promises of God, do not keep silence, don't shut your mouth. And then he says, verse 7, give God no rest. Do you see there? I'm giving no rest until he establishes, until he makes Jerusalem a praise in the earth. This is the word of God. He says, do not give God rest. Do you see there? Some of you pray, you say, well, I have prayed and kept saying, what will people be? God says, do not give him rest. He says, do not give him rest until he makes Jerusalem a praise in the earth. Do not, you know, sometimes when I have a problem, I look for the name of that problem. Whoever that problem is, I told you, I name it my enemy. Oh, I don't know what that enemy, what your enemy is. Is it bronchitis? Is it arthritis? Is it whatever that is? You have to name that enemy and take that name before God. God says, give me no rest, give me no peace until I make Jerusalem the footstool. Hallelujah. Church, let me remind you, I went through the Bible on one count. The Bible has 7,487 promises. Oh, you're not hearing me. I didn't say 10. 7,487 of exceeding great and precious promises that God made for us. Towards us. Hallelujah. So stand on these promises, these 7,000 plus promises. You must know them. Tell your neighbor, know the promises. Say, know them. Church, these promises, the ones you claim are yours. Somebody say glory. Glory. The ones you claim are yours. The ones you don't claim are also yours, even though you will not benefit from them. If you don't claim them, they are still yours, because it's still in the book. Tell your neighbor, I will claim the promises. I will claim the promises. Abraham, the Bible said, God promised Abraham at the age of 75 that he was going to be a father of many nations. Abraham waited and waited. For almost 11 years, he didn't see the promise coming to pass. His wife went to him and said, go and sleep with a lady and get a child. He went and had a child called Ishmael. And the wife came to God and God said, this is not the child. This is not the promise. The promise is coming. From 86 to 100, Abraham had to wait another 14 years for God to bring that promise to pass. With Sarah, who was now in her 90s. Sarah was 90 when she gave birth. The Bible said Abraham did not stagger at the promises of God. Tell your neighbor, do not stagger. Say, do not stagger. Don't waver at the promises of God. The Bible says, who believes, who against hope, believes in hope. Abraham, even though there was no He wants one promise. Hallelujah. And the Bible says in Romans 4:19, and not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body that was now dead. How can a 100-year-old man give birth? Does it make sense in our natural life that today a 100-year-old man who is now dysfunctional is now able to give birth? And his wife who is 90, her womb is all dead. It is not even menopause, it's menostop. She's now even at menostop. The Bible says she got planted a born a baby in that dead womb. Hallelujah. He did not consider the deadness of his wife's womb, neither of his body, not the deadness of Sarah's womb. The Bible says in verse 20 of Romans 4, he staggered not at the promises of God through unbelief. He did not stagger, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded, verse 21, that what he has promised, he was able to perform. And the Bible says, and it was imputed to Abraham for righteousness. Church, I have to tell you, you don't need to be holy or godly or saved to be righteous. Jesus says, just believe in me. Just accept me as your Lord and Savior, and I will impute my righteousness upon you. That's why we are righteous. Not because of what we have done. It is because of what Jesus did. So when somebody says you are ungrateful, you are unworthy, say, I am righteous before God. Because Jesus is very sincere for me. Somebody say, hallelujah. A powerful Christian is the one who stands on the word of God, church. Who remembers the word of God. The promises of God will solve the problems of your life. That's what it does. Amen. Do not doubt God. That's what I've been trying to say to you this morning. Say, don't doubt God. Say, I will not doubt God. If you want to doubt anything, doubt your doubts. You can doubt your doubts because they are unreliable. But don't doubt the word of God. Somebody say, I will believe.
I will believe.
Hallelujah. Look at what Isaiah 41:21 says. Isaiah 41:21. This is the word of God to us, his children. Read it. What does it say? Produce your cause, says the Lord. Bring forth your strong reasons. God says, bring your strong reasons to me, says the God of Jacob. This scripture is a blank check to everyone who knows the promises of God and stands in them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Church, let me remind you of some of the promises and let me end. Quickly, some of the everyday promises that God has made us, in case you are not sure, let me just remind you. You know, there are times when you go through trials and you say you are tired. God gave you Isaiah 40:31. He says, wait on me and I will renew your strength. He says, when you have no strength, when you have no might, I will increase your strength. Hallelujah. When you say nobody loves me, God says in Jeremiah 31:3, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Somebody is not hearing what I'm saying this morning. When you say to God, I can't go on. God says, and you say, God, I can't take it anymore. God says, read Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 12:9. He says, my grace is sufficient for you. That's what he says. Somebody shout glory. You say, I do not know what to do, God. God says, lean on, not on my own, but on your own understanding. I will direct you. That's what he says in Proverbs 3:6. In Philippians 4:19, when you say to God, I can't make ends meet, God says, I will supply all your needs according to your riches in glory. Is somebody here? In Galatians 6:9, when you say God is not worth it, I have tried my best, I can't go on any further. God says, do not faith, keep doing good. You will see the rewards of what I promise. Amen? When you say to God, I am afraid. Have you been there before when you are afraid? You have been diagnosed with a sickness and you are fearful. Your son is not well or your family is going through a major challenge and you are afraid. What did God say? He said in 2 Timothy 2:17, he said that fear did not come from me. When you say, God, this burden is too heavy for me, what did he say in Psalm 65:22? He said, cast your burden upon me, and I will sustain you. I am reminding you of God's promises. When you say to God, I am lonely, I am a lone God, what did he say to you in his word? In Hebrews 13:5, God says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. If somebody believes it, put your hands together for me. Church, stop fearing or worshiping your problems. Stop worshiping that problem. Know your promises. Instead of worshiping that problem, know what God said about the problem so that you can fix it. The promise of God is greater than your problems. Somebody shall go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when you read the Bible 365 times in the scripture, the Bible says, fear not. Do not be afraid. 365 times. Regardless of what you are going through, regardless of the issues that you are facing, the problems that are coming against you, and you're not sure you are afraid. 300, that is one for every day of your life. Every day of the year, God gives you one. He says, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I will be with you. Don't be afraid. Tell everyone, don't be afraid. Hallelujah. Help yourself this morning. Stop meditating on your problems. You give the problems power over you when you worship it. When you meditate on it, the problems become your God. And God becomes small in your eyes. Put God, magnify God before you, and your problems will dissolve before your eyes. Is somebody with me this morning? Oh, you didn't hear me. I said, don't confront your problems with the problems. Confront your problems with the word of God. Somebody say, I will confront my problems. Hallelujah. And you know, many of us here, if the truth be told, we know how to explain our problems. We know how to explain our problems. We can take hours explaining our problems as we are going through. But we are too lazy or ignorant to know the promises of God. I want you to switch your mind this morning. The man in John chapter 5, the Bible said he was dead for 38 years. Jesus shows up that morning at the well of Bethsaida and said to him, would you like to be made whole? Jesus gave him an opportunity. He said, would you like to be healed? Simple yes or no. The man began to recount his problems. Oh, Jesus, when I want to go, if somebody goes before me, my father did this, my mother did this. He began to say, Jesus said, do you want to be whole? Stop listing your problems. Know the promises of God. Somebody say, know his promises. When you know the promises, you will give yourself permission to know what to do when the problems of God come. Give yourself permission to know God's word. That's all I've been saying to you this morning. Is somebody here today? Shout glory.
Glory.
You know, the Bible said of Jesus, finally, Satan tempted Jesus 3 times in the wilderness after he had fasted 40 days. And Jesus did not allow Satan to engage. He told the devil, it is written. Word of God, because Jesus is the Word and he knows the promises that he made, he was able to correct the devil when the devil came to him. When Satan said, turn these stones into bread, Jesus said, it is written. When he said, worship me, Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. Jesus was able to give Satan his word. Tell your neighbor, know the promises of God. And in that verse in Matthew 4, the Bible said, after the devil had tried 3 times and failed. In verse 11 of Matthew 4, the Bible said, then the devil left him. Do you know that when you resist the devil, he will flee from you? Do you know that when you resist the devil, he will flee from you? God wants you to know his promises. Today, I want somebody to believe me when I tell you, the problems that come to us, they are not all for the problem of God. Some of the things that will happen to you, God may need your attention. But most of the challenges that we face is from the pit of hell. But God says, if you know my promises and remember them, you'll be have chosen to magnify our problems, and we have ignored the promises that will solve the problems. And today we ask you, help us to know your word as we read it. Give us understanding of your 7,000 plus promises that you have made towards us. We refuse to be victims of the words of the devil. We refuse to bow to the plan and the schemes of the enemy. Today we stand under the auspices of the commander of the host of heaven. Today we come before your throne and we ask you, God, fulfill your promises that you gave to us, because it's no longer delay. You said I will destine my word to perform it. Today we declare, let your word be performed in our lives.
Hallelujah. 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 God bless you.
promises.